Good morning, friends. Welcome back. Myself, Dr. Jibran Ahmed, presents to you Simply Pathology. And today we are back with another very, very important lecture. So as you all know, in the previous lecture, we had read about innate immunity. And in this lecture, we are now starting with adaptive immunity. So myself, Dr. Jibran Ahmed, presents to you Simply Pathology. And first of all, I would like to thank all of you for showing all the love. And I would really like to thank all my viewers for subscribing and sharing and commenting on and for all the good wishes that they have given. So with this positive note, let us start with today's lecture. So adaptive immune system. Okay, so we have already read about the innate immune system and the components. So the adaptive immune system is consisting of lymphocytes and their products, including antibodies. Okay, so the adaptive immunity can be divided into two. Okay, so one is humoral immunity, which is providing protection against extracellular microbes and their toxin. Whereas the cellular immunity or cell-mediated immunity is providing defense against intracellular microbes. So this is very, very, very important that humoral immunity is providing protection against the extracellular microbe. That is why I have underlined that. And the cell-mediated immunity is providing defense against the intracellular microbes. Yes. Moving ahead, humoral immunity is mediated by B lymphocytes. Why we call it as B lymphocytes? Because they are derived from the bone marrow. Okay, so it is mediated by the B lymphocytes and their secreted products. Okay, antibodies. Okay, immunoglobulins. Okay, so B lymphocytes and the secreted products, that is the antibodies. So AB stands for antibodies. Okay, and antibodies are also called as immunoglobulins. Okay, so short form for immunoglobulin is IG. And there are five basic types of immunoglobulin that we know: IgG, IgA, IgM, IgE, IgD. We call it as gamete. Whereas the cell-mediated immunity is mediated by T lymphocyte. Why the term T has been used? Because it is thymus derived. Okay. Just a basic thing. So this is a B lymphocyte. This is a T lymphocyte. Both the B and T lymphocyte is having certain receptor. Okay, as we can see, the receptor has been shown in black and has also been labeled. And these receptors are going to recognize the antigen. Okay, so this is the basic thing that you should know. Moving ahead, now what is a naive lymphocyte? You know what is meaning of naive? A person who is who doesn't know anything or who is inexperienced, that is called as naive. So an immunologically inexperienced lymphocyte, meaning a lymphocyte that has not encountered an antigen yet, that is called as a naive lymphocyte. Okay, so once they have encountered an antigen or once they become activated, okay, they are going to differentiate into effector cells. Okay, effector cells, the function of which is to eliminate the microbes. And some of them are going to differentiate into memory cells. So what are memory cells? Memory cells are those lymphocytes that are going to remember these pathogens. So if in the future those same pathogen, okay, they enter the body, then these lymphocytes can mount a greater response, a more powerful response. Okay, so the memory cell, they remember the pathogen even years later, and they remain in a state of heightened awareness or reacts rapidly when encounters the same microbe again. Okay, now moving ahead, what are the components of the humoral immunity? Let us see. Actually, these are the components of the adaptive immunity, not humoral. Okay, this is a mistake over here. The components of adaptive immunity. So the components of adaptive immunity are the B lymphocyte, helper T cell, cytotoxic T lymphocyte, and regulatory T cell. All of these are components of adaptive immunity. Okay, these are not humoral, is adaptive immunity. Humoral is your B lymphocyte, and the T lymphocytes come under CMI, cell mediated immunity. Okay. Moving ahead, we are just going to see the general functions of B lymphocytes. Okay, so what do they do? So see, this is a B lymphocyte that I have drawn. Okay, that is shown in blue. And they are having certain receptor, if you can see on the surface of B lymphocyte, a certain receptor. And these receptors are nothing but the antibodies, okay? Antibodies serve as receptor on the surface of B lymphocyte. So once they are encountering a microbe, what will happen? The B lymphocyte is going to differentiate into a plasma cell. And this plasma cell is going to secrete antibodies. And these antibodies, they are going to coat the microbes, as we can see. And they are going to take those microbes to the phagocytes and lead to phagocytosis of the microbes. So in general, what are the functions of the B lymphocyte? Neutralization of the microbe, as we saw now, phagocytosis and complement activation. So these are the three important functions of the B lymphocyte. Coming next, the helper T cells. Remember, the helper T cells, they are like the commissioner of police. Themselves, they are not going to do anything, but they are going to give orders in the form of cytokines. So the commissioner of police, he himself doesn't go and catch the thief. He is going to send the local police. He is going to send the inspectors, okay, and the constables to go and do the work. So the helper T cells themselves, they don't do anything, but they release a number of cytokines, okay, that goes and does many functions. So this is the helper T lymphocyte, as we have seen. And this helper T lymphocyte, as you can see, they also have certain receptors. Okay, these receptors which are shown in blue, and these receptors are going to recognize antigens, okay, which is presented by the antigen presenting cell. So if you see the one which is shown in green, okay, so this is the antigen presenting cell, APC. Okay, for example, the antigen presenting cell is our dendritic cells. These are star shaped cells. That is why I have also drawn them in the form of a star. So what they do, they are going to ingest the microbe. As we see, the microbe has been ingested inside the dendritic cells, which are the antigen presenting cell. And these dendritic cells, these are going to present the antigen to the helper T cells. Once the antigen has been presented, the helper T cell will now become activated and they are going to release cytokines. Okay, these cytokines are going to cause activation of the macrophages, inflammation, and they are also going to cause activation, okay, in the form that they are going to stimulate the proliferation and differentiation of B and T lymphocytes. Okay, so these are the three important functions of the helper T lymphocyte. See, themselves they are not doing anything, but they are releasing certain cytokines which are performing all the functions. Moving ahead, now the cytotoxic T cells. Now the cytotoxic T cells, they are like the army. You know, that army, they don't take decision. They are following the orders. Okay, so they will follow the orders. Okay, once they know that they, for example, at the border, when they are looking that any enemy is coming inside the border, they straight away, they start killing them. Okay, so once they encounter an antigen, they don't do anything. They themselves kill. That is why we are calling them the army. So the cytotoxic T lymphocyte, again, which is shown in this diagram, okay, they are going to act against those cells which are infected with microbial antigen. So they are not directly acting on the microbes. Instead, they are acting on the cells which have been infected with the microbe, as we can see in this picture. And what they do, we will come to the mechanism of this later on in the later on video series. But they can cause direct killing of the infected cell. So the infected cells, if you see how they are being destroyed, and if the infected cell is destroyed, the microbes are also destroyed in the process. Okay. Lastly, we are having the regulatory T cells. So what does the regulatory T cell do? So the function of the regulatory T cells is to suppress the activation of the helper T cells. So the helper T lymphocyte is not allowed to activate. So ultimately what will happen? There is a suppression of immune response. Okay. So what I want to say over here is that our immune system has certain control in our body. Okay, so if our immune system, once it is activated, there has to be certain mechanism that can actually stop that immune system. Because if the immune system is allowed to act uncontrollably, it can destroy or it can cause harm to our own body. So the immune responses has to be controlled. Okay, moving ahead now. Lymphocyte diversity. Let us read about lymphocyte diversity. It is a very, very simple topic. Let us read. So see, suppose this is the lymphocyte, okay? So before that lymphocyte has been exposed to an antigen, okay? It is having a specificity for large number of antigens, okay? So once they are exposed to an antigen, okay, they will cause recruitment of antigen-specific lymphocytes. So if you see over here, the antigen has been shown in like a blue triangle, okay, like a small blue triangle. And there are certain lymphocytes which are just going to act against this particular antigen. Okay, so these group of lymphocytes, okay, which are acting against a particular antigen, they form a clone. Okay, they form a clone. So group of lymphocytes with the same specificity, that means acting against the same antigen, is called as a clone. And all these lymphocytes, they have the same specificity and all can recognize this particular antigen. So just to revise and just to give you an example, for example, all of us are reading medical science, okay, and after completing our medical science, we become general physicians. So a general physician or a GP, general practitioner, not a general physician, a general practitioner, a GP that we say, he practices everything. He practices medicine, surgery, all things he will practice, okay. But once he has completed the post graduation, means he has been exposed to an antigen, that means he has undergone training under, for example, surgery, then after passing, he is going to practice surgery only. That means there is a clone of doctors called as surgeons, which is going to only look after the surgical cases. Okay, for example, there's a group of doctor that is the gynecologist or the obstetricians. They are only going to see the obstetric cases, that is, they are going to deliver the babies, or they are going to cater to any kind of gynecological problem. So we say that these are the clone of doctors called as gynecologists. Okay, similarly, even in our body, we are having certain arrangement like this. So for a certain antigen, there is a certain group of lymphocyte, and these group of lymphocyte, they form a clone. Okay, that means there's a, these are the group of lymphocyte that is going to act against only one particular antigen. Similarly, if you see, if there are different kinds of antigen, there will be another clone. For example, if you see over here, there is a separate antigen shown in brown. And for these group of antigens, we are having certain lymphocytes shown in blue. Again, there can be another clone. Okay, for example, there are certain antigens over here, which is circular and which is red. And against them, there is certain group of lymphocyte, which is shown in green. So this is how, this is what a clone of lymphocyte is. Okay, I hope this is clear. Now moving ahead, a very important point. So how many lymphocytes do I have in our body? There are 10 to the power of 12 lymphocytes present in healthy adults. And if we group them, if we divide them, then it is estimated that we are having around 10 to the power of 7 to 10 to the power of 9 clones. What does this mean? This means that for any particular antigen, the number of lymphocytes that are specific for that particular antigen is very small. Try to understand, I'll repeat. So this means that the number of lymphocytes which are specific for any one particular antigen is very small. Surprisingly, even these small group of lymphocytes which are specific for one particular antigen, they can accomplish the difficult task of combating various microbes. That means our body is running with less number of lymphocytes as compared to the number of microbes which are available. But still our immune system is quite efficient. With a small number of lymphocytes, it can combat a large number of microbes. So this is what they want to say over here. Moving ahead, a very, very, very important topic is the lymphocyte antigen receptor diversity. So we are going to read about the receptors which are present on the surface of the lymphocytes. So I am saying that antigen receptor diversity. So this is which antigen receptor? The antigen receptor which is present on the surface of the lymphocyte. So the antigen receptor diversity is generated by somatic recombination of the genes that will encode the antigen receptors. What does this mean? So what happens, that first try to understand that at the surface of the lymphocyte, we are having certain antigen receptors, and there are certain genes in our body which is going to encode for that antigen receptor. Now you all know that any kind of antigen receptor is nothing but a protein, and a protein is produced by transcription and translation of DNA. So there are certain, and genes are made up of DNA. Okay. So there are certain genes which are encoding these particular antigen receptors. So what happens that in usual situation or in usual condition, okay, what will happen that these are the genes, okay, which is responsible for encoding the antigen receptors. So in normal conditions, they are spatially separated. These genes are separated, okay, so that they cannot encode any antigen receptor. Okay, so during lymphocyte maturation, so remember one thing, that lymphocytes are produced, both B and T lymphocytes are produced at the level of bone marrow. Okay, now only after maturation they can perform their function. So maturation of B lymphocyte is taking place in the bone marrow, whereas maturation of T lymphocyte is taking place in the thymus. And what happens during this maturation process? These genes which were specially separated, they are now bridged or they are now connected. There is a DNA bridging. And what happens that in between them, the DNA sequence variation are introduced. While joining the antigen receptor genes, what is happening? That a DNA sequence variation has been introduced while joining the antigen receptor genes. And this process is taking place at the time of lymphocyte maturation. As I already mentioned before, that the maturation of T lymphocyte, which is occurring in the thymus, and the maturation of B lymphocyte, which is occurring at the level of the bone marrow. So it is during these times that this DNA sequence variation has been introduced. Okay, so what will happen? This DNA sequence that has been introduced, for example, for one lymphocyte, they have one sequence. For another lymphocyte, they are having another sequence. So the resulting antigen receptor that is going to form, that is going to be transcribed and translated, will be different for every lymphocyte. So this process is creating many different types of genes that can be transcribed and translated into many different kind of antigen receptors, thus creating a diversity. So meaning of diversity is what? Diversity means variations. Okay, so why it is necessary? Because there are thousands of different kinds of microbes, and every lymphocyte should have a specificity for different kinds of microbes. So the receptors has to be different also. That is why we are having the antigen receptor diversity. I will just quickly explain you once again this part so you can understand nicely. See, you have to understand that every lymphocyte is having an antigen receptor on their surface. Okay, and this antigen receptor is encoded by a certain gene that is called as a antigen receptor gene. Now these genes are going to encode certain proteins, and these proteins are actually the antigen receptor. Okay, this is clear. So normally the B and T lymphocytes are produced at the level of the bone marrow, and in that situation the antigen receptor genes in these lymphocytes, they are spatially separated and they cannot transcribe or translate any protein. Also, in simple term, they cannot produce any antigen receptors. So during lymphocyte maturation, okay, when the lymphocyte undergoes maturation, these specially separated genes, they are connected with each other by means of introduction of DNA sequence variation. So we all know that all the DNA is having certain sequence, so different sequences are used to bridge these gaps. Okay, so once these DNA sequence variations are introduced, these are different for different lymphocytes. So every lymphocyte will have a different antigen receptor, which will be specific for different kinds of microbe. This is called as antigen receptor diversity. Moving ahead, if you see, and what are the genes? So the genes which are responsible for this somatic recombination. So this process wherein the DNA, I will just repeat one thing. This process, okay, wherein the DNA sequence variation have been introduced, this is called as somatic recombination. Okay, so this entire process that we read is called as somatic recombination. The genes which are responsible for somatic recombination, they are called as RAG1 and RAG2 genes. The full form is recombination activating genes. Now they generate certain enzymes called as RAG proteins, which will bring about the somatic recombination. Now if there are defects or mutation in the RAG genes, it will lead to failure of lymphocyte maturation. Also, we have to understand one thing, that the antigen receptor genes are present in all cells of the body, but the somatic recombination will only take place in the B and the T lymphocyte. Okay, remember the antigen receptor for the T lymphocyte is called as TCR, that is the T cell receptor, whereas that for the B lymphocyte is the immunoglobulin. So the receptor at the level of the B lymphocyte is nothing but the immunoglobulin. Okay, now let us move ahead. Okay, now again, this is a very, very important slide. So what we see over here, first try to understand, excuse me, this is the T lymphocyte, okay? And this is the B lymphocyte. And both of them is having antigen receptor. They have a receptor on the surface to recognize the antigen. So at the level of T lymphocyte, we are having TCR or T cell receptor. And at the level of B lymphocyte, we are having immunoglobulin, IG. Now, this antigen receptor has been coded by certain genes, as I already told you, and they are called as antigen receptor genes. Okay, so the antigen receptor genes at the level of T lymphocyte is called as, okay, it is called as T cell receptor gene, whereas at the level of the B lymphocyte is called as immunoglobulin gene, IG gene. Okay, so each of these genes, they have a unique DNA sequence, and I told you why. It is because of DNA of somatic recombination, and this can be demonstrated by certain molecular methods like RT-PCR, polymerase chain reaction, reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. So what is the importance of this somatic recombination? Remember, because of this recombination, okay, a T cell will have a T cell receptor, and this T cell receptor will serve as a marker of T cell lineage, whereas the immunoglobulin receptor on the surface of the B cell will form the marker of B cell lineage. So it is very important. What is the importance that we are having many kind of leukemias and lymphomas that arise from lymphocytes? So those arising from the T lymphocyte is called as T cell leukemia or lymphoma, and those arising from the B lymphocyte is called as B cell leukemia lymphoma. Okay, so to know, it is very important to know whether the lymphoma is arising from the T cell or the B cell. Why? Because the treatment for both these lymphomas, leukemias, is different. So that is why this somatic recombination helps us to understand which is coming from the T cell, which is coming from the B cell. Moving ahead, the T cell gene has its unique DNA rearrangement, okay? Therefore, marker of T cell lineage, whereas the immunoglobulin gene is having its own unique DNA rearrangement, that is the marker of the B cell lineage, not the T. It should be B cell lineage, okay? There is a B cell lineage, okay? Now, I will like to say you something over here. Now, another important aspect of this somatic recombination is this. When we have to differentiate that whether the lesion inside the lymph node, okay, whether it is neoplastic or non-neoplastic, or you know, so what we have considered over here, these are the two lymph nodes. So we are having two lymph nodes over here, okay, and these lymph nodes, okay, on the left hand side, the lymph node is having multiple clone. Multiple clone means there are different lymphocytes for different group of microbes or antigens. Okay, so whenever there are multiple clones inside a lymph node, then we say that these lymphocytes are non-neoplastic, means there is no cancer inside of that. Non-neoplastic means it is a reactive means, for example, there is some kind of infection. So because of that, there is multiple clones. We call these as polyclonal in nature, and therefore these are non-neoplastic lymphocytes. This is a very, very important concept. Okay, another thing is that on the right hand side, these lymph node, they are composed of lymphocytes which are all specific for a particular kind of antigen. So they are a single clone and all are having the same somatic recombination. Therefore, we will call these lymphocytes as monoclonal in nature, that is comprising of a single clone. And such kind of clonality is seen in neoplastic lymphocyte. That means now I can, okay, sorry, okay, this is changed, okay. So now I can just say that these are neoplastic lymphocytes, okay. because they are just composed of a single clone. Okay, so somatic recombination helps us find the lineage, whether it is of T cell lineage or whether it is of B cell lineage, and also they help us to differentiate a non-neoplastic lymphocytes from neoplastic lymphocytes. Okay, moving ahead now, by assessing the clonality of the antigen receptor genes rearrangements, we can assess the lymphoid neoplasms. Yes, as we already explained before. And how we can assess the clonality? There are certain molecular assays called as RT-PCR. So just remember one thing, if by this method we see that the lymphocyte population is polyclonal, in that case they are non-neoplastic, and if they are monoclonal, then they, in this case it is neoplastic. Okay. Now moving ahead, the T lymphocytes, if you see, now the T lymphocytes can be divided into three main types. There are three main types of T lymphocytes. One is the helper T lymphocyte, the function of which is to stimulate the B lymphocyte to make antibody and to activate other leukocytes, example the phagocytes, to destroy the microbes. What is the function of cytotoxic killer T cell? It is to kill the infected cells. The cells which are harboring the microbes, they are going to kill that cell plus the microbe. And thirdly, we are having the regulatory T cell, which is going to limit the immune response and prevent reactions against the self antigens. Okay. Now T cell, they develop in the thymus. As I already explained, the maturation occurs in the thymus, and they are developing from precursors that arise from the hematopoietic stem cells in the bone marrow. The mature T cells in the blood, they constitute approximately 60 to 70% of all the lymphocytes. Now, this is how a T cell receptor looks like. Now, first of all, let me show you. This is an antigen presenting cell that is on the top. Okay. And below we are having CD4 plus T cell. Okay. Now, on top, this is the plasma membrane of the antigen presenting cell. And here is the plasma membrane of the T cell. Okay. That is the CD4 plus T cell. Now remember one thing, that on the surface of all cells of our body, we are having certain molecules called as MHC, that is major histocompatibility complex. Here I will say you just few things about the MHC, because the next topic that I am going to teach you is the MHC only, that is the next video lecture will be on MHC. So what is important in this aspect is that MHC molecule, okay, there are two types of MHC. One is MHC class 1, one is MHC class 2. So these MHC molecules are present in our body cells, in all cells of our body, and it is very, very important to have these MHC molecules. Okay, why? Because these MHC molecules, they give certain recognition to our cells. So there are two types of MHC molecule. One is class 1 and one is class 2. So class 1 MHC is present in all the nucleated cells of our body, whereas the class 2 MHC is present basically in the antigen presenting cells and the macrophages. So what you will see over here, that this is the dendritic cell, this is the antigen presenting cell which is having class 2 MHC, and this MHC is very, very important. Okay, because without MHC they cannot present an antigen to the T cell. So what we are watching over here is that an antigen presenting cell is presenting an antigen with the help of a MHC molecule to the CD4 plus T cell. So this class 2 MHC is composed of two chains. One is an alpha chain, one is the beta chain. Okay. Now over here, if you see, the CD4 plus T cell is composed of a T cell receptor, which is composed of certain proteins that is called as CD3 proteins. So if you see CD3 proteins on the left hand side, composed of epsilon and gamma. Again, where we are having certain side chains. Okay. These are the side chains. There are two side chains. And if you see the T cell receptor, if you see, they are composed of alpha and beta heterodimer, which is linked by a sulfide bond. There is a disulfide linkage for alpha and beta receptor. And again, there are CD3 proteins that is composed of epsilon and delta. So we are having in total, there are six polypeptide chains along with two alpha beta, that is T cell receptor heterodimer. This together is called as T cell receptor complex, and they are responsible for producing signal 1. Okay. Now also we will see that on the antigen presenting cell there is another receptor called as CD80 CD86. This combines with CD28 receptor present on the CD4 cell, and they are responsible for production of signal number 2. So what is the importance over here? The importance is that both signal 1 and both signal 2 is necessary for producing the response, okay, for producing the transduction, signal transduction, or to produce the T cell response, both signal 1 and signal 2 is required. Also, what is shown on the left hand side, if you see, there is a CD4. Because there is a CD4 over here, which is a co-receptor, therefore we call this T cell as CD4 plus T cell. If CD8 is present, then we call it as CD8 plus T cell. So essentially CD4 and CD8 have everything is same, just that the CD4 is having CD4, that is shown on the left hand side of the diagram, whereas CD8 is having just CD8. Okay, moving ahead. The T cell is recognizing specific cell bound antigens by means of an antigen specific T cell receptor. I have already discussed all these points, just I am enumerating them. Now the T cell receptor, okay, they are composed of a disulfide linked heterodimer, as I already showed you, which is made up of alpha and beta polypeptide chain. And each such subunit is composed of two region. One is the variable region, one is the constant region. Now the alpha beta T cell receptor recognizes the peptide antigens that are presented by the MHC molecules on the surface of the antigen presenting cells. Now, by limiting the specificity of the T cells for the peptides displayed by the cell surface MHC molecule, called the MHC restriction, the immune system ensures that the T cells will see only the cells which are associated with antigens. Now, this is a very, very important concept. What they are trying to say that our T cell will not react to just like, you know, any antigen is there, so they are just reacting. No, they are going to react only to those antigens which are presented by the antigen presented by the APC cell. Okay, and these APC cell, they are having MHC class 2. So this MHC has to be present. So the peptide antigen has to be presented by a molecule called as the MHC, which this is called as MHC restriction. So what is, two things are essential over here. One is that the peptide antigen has to be presented by a certain cell called as the APC cell. And the second thing is that not only the APC cell, they have to be presented by the MHC receptor present on the surface of the APC. And the APC is having a class of MHC called as MHC2. So this is called as MHC restriction. That is, the T cell is going to respond only if the antigen has been presented by the MHC receptor present on the surface of the antigen presenting cell. Now, if you see, I have just enumerated the same thing. Now, an APC can present antigen by two ways. Either it has ingested the microbe and then it is presenting the microbial antigen with the help of MHC. Okay, or the APC has ingested certain protein molecules and then they are presenting the protein molecule to the T cell by means of MHC. So now and only now they can present the antigen to the T cell. Okay, moving ahead, each T cell receptor is non-covalently linked to 6 polypeptide chain that I already showed you, and they are actually the CD3 complex and the psi dimer. Okay, there are a total of 6, which is already shown in the diagram before. These are invariant. Invariant means they are identical in all T cells, whether it be helper T cell, whether it be CD4, CD8, any kind of T cell, this part is same in all of them. And they are responsible for transduction of signals into the T cells that are triggered by binding of antigen to the T cell receptor. And they are responsible for the signal 1, if you remember that diagram, okay, the signal 1 activating signals, okay. Now, one more thing is the T cell is also expressing the CD4, CD8, CD28 and integrin. Remember, if the T cell is expressing CD4, it is called as CD4 lymphocyte. And if it is expressing CD8, then it is called as CD8 plus T lymphocyte. Another group that is expressed is the CD28. Okay, and the integrins. Remember, the CD28 that is expressed by the T cell is also important. Acha, one thing is that CD4 and CD8 are expressed on two mutually exclusive subset of alpha beta T cells. Means what? Means either a T cell will express CD4 or they will express CD8, but in one T cell both CD4 and CD8 is not expressed. Okay, acha, remember that 60% of the mature T cells, they are CD4 plus T lymphocyte, whereas 30% of the mature T cells, they are CD8 plus T lymphocyte. Okay, so this CD4 plus T lymphocyte is functioning as a cytokine secreting helper cells. Oh, so the helper T cells are also called as the CD4 plus cells. Okay, that is going to assist the macrophages and the B lymphocytes to combat the infection. Whereas the CD8 plus T lymphocyte, they are functioning as the... Achha, yes, we have already seen this part, the function of CD4 plus cell. Whereas the CD8 plus cell will function as the cytotoxic or the killer T lymphocyte that I have seen before. And that directly destroys the host cells or the infected cells, which is harboring the microbes. Now the CD4 and CD8 cells, they are serving as the co-receptor and T cell activation. So if the MCQ is, the function of CD4 and CD8 is what? They are acting as a co-receptor. CD4 plus T cells, they are going to bind to class 2 MHC molecule, whereas the CD8 molecules are going to bind to class 1 MHC molecules. Okay, moving ahead, to respond, the T cells have to recognize not only the antigen MHC complex, but there are certain additional signals, as I told, the signal number 2, which is provided by the CD28 of the APC. Now by the CD28 of the APC. Actually, I think that I remember it was CD80 and 81. Okay, just we will confirm that once. If we just go back and confirm once the diagram. Okay. So CD28 is the one which is present on the T cells, whereas CD80 and 86 is present on the antigen presenting cell. Yes, so just remember this thing. Okay, so let us move ahead. To respond, the T cells have to recognize not only the antigen MHC complex, but also additional signals which are provided by the CD28. Okay, CD28 is present in at the level of the T cells. Okay, not APC. Here it is wrong. CD28 of the T cells, whereas CD80, 86 of the antigen presenting cells. Now both the CD4 and CD8 co-receptor initiate signals that are necessary for activation of the T cells. Okay. Integrins are adhesion molecules that promote attachment of the T cells to the antigen presenting cells. Okay. Now let us move ahead. Now the last leg, that is the B lymphocyte. Now B lymphocytes are the only cells in the body which is capable of producing antibodies. Okay. They develop from precursors in the bone marrow. And mature B cells, they constitute around 10 to 20% of the circulating peripheral lymphocyte. They are also present in the peripheral lymphoid tissue like the spleen, lymph node and mucosa associated lymphoid tissue that is called as MALT. Now how the B cells will bind to the antigen? The B cell will bind with the help of antigen receptor complex. Now the question is, what is an antigen receptor complex? These are membrane bound antibodies of IgM and IgD isotype or IgD class, which are present on the surface of all mature but naive B cells. Now let us look at how the B cell looks like, B cell receptor looks like. So this in black that I have shown is the plasma membrane of the B lymphocyte. Now it is composed of certain B cell receptor which is formed by the IgM antibody as is shown over here. Also this IgM, as you see, they are going to bind to the antigen. And there are certain other molecules also called as Ig beta and Ig alpha. Now they are very similar. These molecules are very similar to the CD3 and psi dimer, which was present in the T cell receptor. Okay. Now just see one more thing. This Ig beta and Ig alpha is responsible for signal number 1. Okay. Whereas the complement proteins which attach to the antigen and which stimulate the CD21 receptor, they are responsible for signal number 2. Moving ahead, if you see, just to enumerate, this Ig beta and Ig alpha, they are also called as CD79B and CD79A respectively, and they are similar to CD3 and psi protein of the T cell receptor complex, as I already mentioned, and both of them are involved in signal transduction. They are responsible for signal 1 and The CD21, okay, so B cell is expressing the type 2 complement receptor called as the CD21 or CR2. Now, they recognize the complement products generated during innate immune response to the microbes. As we can see in the diagram, that they are responsible for recognizing the complement proteins. Also, very important one clinical aspect is that it is through these CD21 or CR2 receptor, that is through these receptors, a virus infects the B cell. Which is that virus? EBV virus, called as Epstein-Barr virus. Moving ahead, all the same thing that we have seen, we are going to discuss that. This antigen receptor complex is the antigen binding component of the B cell receptor complex, that is the BCR complex. Okay. After antigenic stimulation, what happens that the B lymphocyte, they get converted into plasma cell, which is going to secrete antibody, and they get converted to long-lived memory cells. Now, a single plasma cell can secrete thousands of antibodies. Now, moving ahead, antibody secreting plasma cells detected in the human peripheral blood, they are called as plasma blast. In addition to this, the complement receptor 2 or the CD21, the B cell also express CD40 receptor, very, very important. This is very important because it is through the CD40 receptor by which it is going to receive the signals from the helper T cells. Now, the CD21, which is expressed by the B cells, are also used by the Epstein-Barr virus as a receptor to enter and infect the B cells. So thank you very much, guys, for watching this lecture. Hope you have enjoyed this lecture. Please do subscribe and please do comment if you have any doubts, and don't forget to share with those who need these lectures. Thank you very much, guys. Stay tuned for further lectures.